Morning lay sprawled in sleepy comfort in the front yards along Gordonsville's single residential street. The banker's rooster, having several times proclaimed the fact that he was up and doing, walked proudly toward the dusty thoroughfare.
The sheriff sent you himself, you say? I can't imagine why.
Must be important.
He said you should come over to the bank right away.
The banker, his shirt tail hanging out, was just leaving the front door of the large frame house, accompanied by two men, both of them dusty from hard riding.
I don't know. This is mighty odds, is all I can say.
Bantam Audio Publishing presents A Ranger Rides to Town, adapted from the short story by Louis L'Amour. Over on Main Street, outside the bank, a rider clad in a linen duster sat astride a blood bay with the reins of three other horses in his hands. A rifle lay across his knees. A fourth man, likewise dusty from the trail, leaned against a storefront 20 yards down the street with a rifle in his hands.
He could have let Jim Kane handle it. Jim's usually the first one in nowadays.
I guess he thought it was too important, Mr. Hayes. He said we couldn't tell anybody except yourself.
The banker and his escort emerged from between two buildings and headed across Main Street.
Why, the door's open! What in the world?
Hayes quickened his pace, and presently he and his two escorts disappeared inside the bank. At the eastern edge of the settlement, a dry wash had been bridged, and the sound of a horse's hooves on the short wooden span could be heard throughout the town. Suddenly, that bridge thundered with the hoofbeats of a hard-ridden horse. The two men in the street looked up sharply. Behind his house, Tommy Ryan, 13 years old and small for his age, was heading for the chicken coop to fetch some eggs for breakfast. He glanced around in time to see a man on a hammerhead roan, the horse's side streaked with sweat, charge into the street. The man wore a black, flat-crowned hat, and the two guns in his hands were not there for show.
A ranger? Must be trouble.
The man in the linen duster was closest, and he hesitated, waiting to see who or what was approaching. When he saw the rider with pistols in his hands and a ranger's badge on his chest, he lifted his rifle, but it was too late. The ranger's bullet cut a long furrow the length of his forearm and smashed his elbow. The rifle fell into the street. Numb with shock, the seated rider gripped his arm and stared at the blood which now soaked his duster.
Whoa.
The rifleman down the street caught the second bullet just as he himself fired. He stood for an instant, then turned and walked three steps and fell on his face. One spur owl kept turning a moment after he fell. When the shooting was over, one of the banker's escorts lay sprawled in the doorway, his gun on the ground in front of him. The ranger stood over him, gun in hand, staring into the shadowy interior of the bank.
Call the sheriff, someone.
Wow! He caught him red-handed.
Looky here, he shot this one too.
My arm.
Out of the way. Yeah, let me through.
Looks like a ranger.
What happened?
My, a ranger.
Looks like they were robbing the bank.
Let the sheriff through.
Chick Bowdrie. Welcome. I'm Ed Hadley, the sheriff here.
Pleased to meet you.
I didn't know there were any rangers in the country.
Well, looks like I got here just in time.
Hey, that was some shooting, mister.
That's because I caught him by surprise, Sonny. They didn't expect anybody to come in shooting. I had an edge. All right, Hadley, let's take a look inside.
Follow me. Stand back, you men.
Sheriff Hadley led the way into the bank. Two men lay dead on the floor. One of them, a balding gentleman, still in his shirt sleeves. He had been shot through the head at close range. Bowdrie knew without being told that this man must have been the town banker.
His name was Hayes. He was a good man. The town needed him.
Bowdrie turned and looked back towards the door where Hadley was squatting beside the bodies of the other men.
These two are dead. One dead, one wounded outside. You scored a clean sweep, Bowdrie. You got them all.
That's what it looks like.
The ranger's eyes swept over the scene with a swift, all-seeing glance. Then he stepped around Hay's fallen body and back into the banker's private office. It was cool there and undisturbed. Bowdrie paused for a long minute, looking around, considering not only what he saw, but what he had just seen. This room had been the seat of a man's pride, of his life's work. He had been a man who was building something, not only for himself and for those who followed, but for his country. This man was putting down roots, enabling others to do the same. Now he was dead. And for what? So that some two-bit outlaws might have a few dollars to spend on whiskey and women. He walked back through the main room of the bank towards the street. Outside, the wounded man had been helped off his horse and put in handcuffs. Hadley was standing by the hitching rail, talking with some of the townsfolk.
Say, Homer, I'll let you know in a while.
No business today, Hadley. I want the bank closed.
Closed?
What about our payroll?
What?
But my business.
Young Jim King can handle the bank, Bowdrie. He's a good man.
That may be, but I want the bank closed for business. I need to look around. See to it this man gets locked up.
Right.
My arm's busted real bad.
Folks, I'll try to get this investigation over with as quickly as possible, and I'm sorry for any inconvenience. The bank is closed until further notice.
Whatever you say, Bowdrie. You heard the ranger. The bank's closed. Hey, you, come on with me. You're under arrest.
I need a doctor.
One by one, the townsfolk began to wander off in search of breakfast or a hot cup of coffee. But Tommy Ryan just stood there, staring wide-eyed. He had heard stories about lawmen like Chick Bowdrie and Rip Coker, but he had never seen a real live ranger before.
Is there anything I can do to help, Mr. Bowdrie? I'm Tommy Ryan. I never met a ranger before.
Well, thanks, Tommy. Perhaps you can go find the doctor. Tell him he's got a patient in the town jail.
Yes, sir.
Bowdrie's eyes wandered the street, studying the storefronts, the upstairs windows. Who might have been a witness? In a town of early risers, somebody might very well have seen what happened before the holdup began.
G'day, Ranger. Anything I can do? My name's Kent Freed. Hayes was a friend of mine.
The man was tall and broadly built, with blonde hair and friendly eyes.
Nothing anybody can do, I'm afraid. Hayes never had a chance. Shot right through the skull. Same man shot him as shot this other outlaw over here.
You mean you didn't shoot?
I got three of them, if you include that fellow I wounded, but I didn't shoot at this man, and he didn't shoot Hayes.
How can that be? You mean
somebody... There must have been at least one other man in here who killed both the banker and this other outlaw. Whoever it was must have slipped out the back.
Well, that's impossible. Why, everybody in town heard the shooting. Someone would have seen him running away.
Perhaps. Did Hayes have any help at the bank? Who is this Jim Kane, the sheriff mentioned?
Kane? He was Hayes' partner, I guess you'd say. A newcomer around here showed up about a year ago. Why? Are you suggesting this was an inside job?
I'm not suggesting anything at all. I just want to know how much money was in the bank and how much is missing.
Missing? You mean
it's my guess whoever shot Hayes and this other man got whatever it was they came for in the first place. I'd like to talk to Jim Kane if you can find him. Say at the saloon, long about the lunch hour.
I'll give him the message.
Bowdrie watched the tall man depart in the direction of the saloon. Further along, a small group of men was helping Sheriff Hadley lift the body of the fourth outlaw off the street. Freed waved to them as he passed. A number of things didn't fit together here, but Bowdrie knew that they would have to before he was through. He stepped into the street feeling far from confident. The outlaw with the broken arm had been taken to jail and must be questioned. Bowdrie had a hunch he would know nothing. The man who had planned this job would have been shrewd enough to have communicated with only one man. Undoubtedly, the outlaw killed inside the bank. At least that was how it looked now. Bowdrie's own arrival in town had not been by chance. He had been tipped off that a robbery was planned. Someone had thrown a note wrapped around a rock into his campsite only a few hours ago. Who had written it, and why?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.